Christina.
I'm Keandra.
And you already know me. I'm Crystal.
And we're Zael.
You guys, we know we promised you guys a couple of songs, like, you know, some months back, like in October.
We're sorry.
Yeah. We're here for the second song that we owe y'all.
It was Crystal's fault, since y'all know her.
Favorite tales.
But yeah. So we're gonna sing a song by Vashawn Mitchell. The song is "My Worship Is For Real," and we sang this song like some years back, you know, when we first started, or rather, in our early years.
Yeah.
And like, we're just excited about what God is doing in His life.
Yes.
That song really blesses us, mm-hmm. blesses other people. So we're gonna bless y'all with this song. Is that okay?
It's all right.
One, two, three, you.
You don't know my story. For the things that I've been through, you can't feel my pain, what I had to go through to get here. You'll never understand my praise. Don't try to figure it out, because my worship is for real. Because my worship is for real.
I've been through too much not to worship Him. I've been through too much not to worship Him.
Feed my kid, mm-hmm. and as much as you know that you have a potential that's within you,
mm-hmm.
so I would sit home. Even back then, I'm looking back at it, I would try to come up with little businesses, come up with do some little DVDs. But
you sound like me.
It has always been a drive within me, even mm-hmm. at that state. But one day I got tired of being sick and tired, you know, and he would come home. There is a thing of being would come home, spread your legs open. I'm like, no, I don't want to do it, because I know I had a feeling he was out with somebody.
Mm-hmm.
No, you're going to have sex with me. Next thing I know, I'm laying there in tears.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know.
And that is rape.
That was rape. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that was domestic violence. I didn't know that if he got upset and didn't like something,
mm-hmm.
he would twist my arm so hard to the point where, because he didn't want to say that I'm beating you, so he never punched me in my face,
mm-hmm.
but he would use this maneuver with twist my arm where I can't move.
Yeah.
Like, you gonna do what I tell you gonna do.
Mm-hmm.
But because we as women, I'm strong, ain't nobody even hit on me.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think anything was wrong with it,
because
he knew I didn't have nowhere to go anyway.
So all of that, everything you went through, that's how my sister's keeper came.
Oh, you haven't even heard the worst of it, honey.
Oh, it's more.
Oh, child.
It's more?
It is so much. But
you're not with this guy anymore.
Oh, no.
No.
I end up getting my confidence by one day saying, you know what, I'm tired. I had gastric bypass surgery.
How long were you with him before you go into that? Before you decided to say it's over with the marriage?
Okay. 10 years. I was dating him maybe 5. And then I was married for him the rest of the 5.
Okay.
But doing that, I had gastric bypass surgery.
Mm-hmm.
Got my confidence back. A lot of people was like, no, you'll die. I said, I'm either going to die in my house or take the risk of take the chance of dying on the surgery table.
That's right.
So I took that chance. I am a person, if I see something, all you can do is take the risk. If you don't, you'll be stuck in that state that you're at. And right now, I've been taking a risk. Every time, one thing my father can say, he say one thing about Sharina. She wants something, she's going to go out there and make it happen.
That's right.
That's all I know. So I guess God designed me to be like that. But what really, my sister's keeper really came out of several amounts of pain until the point, the deepest pain that I could ever experience was once I did tell him I was going to leave him. And I'm not going to lie, I end up calling myself going out to see somebody else. You know, I never had sex, you know, while I was married to him. But because I was getting ready to leave, he was like, no, to the point where he wanted to stop me and was going to pull a gun out on me and the other young man who I was thinking about leaving him for. In that process, he moved me away to Port St. Lucie.
Who did that?
My ex-husband.
Okay.
He moved me away to Port St. Lucie, and we were looking for a home, because everything here in Florida, you know, there's no homes down here. Rent is expensive. 3 months into moving up there, you know, I was talking to my next-door neighbor, and I was like, I've grown up in church my whole life. I see people, you know, they have a testimony. I said, but I don't know what's my testimony, because I've seen people set free and delivered from drugs, prostitution, demons being cast out, but I don't know what's mine. Not knowing that my daughter would come to me in the kitchen, and she said, and she was 5 years old, I'll never forget that day, and she said, Mommy, I had a bad dream. And I was like, what dream was that? She said, I had a dream that we had a car accident, and Naya was in the car, which was my youngest daughter, and she said, but Naya died. I said, oh, I rebuke that dream in the name of Jesus. The devil is a liar. Not knowing that one day, one Sunday morning, I would wake up refurbishing some furniture, because I love the fixing. I'm very creative. God has gifted me with so many different gifts that they just come, you know, effortlessly. And I was sitting there doing my furniture like, okay, I got my boys' room, thinking everything was okay. Come to find out, you know, go take care of my little hubby. It was his birthday the night before. And my daughter wanted to come with me. She was like, Mama, can I go with you? I was like, not a problem. I told my oldest son that day, I say, you need to stay home, because when your sister wakes up, somebody needs to be there while your father's sleeping. So I'll crank up the car. My daughter, she opens up the back seat. And that week I had been telling her, you need to spend some time with your sister. You need to spend some time with your sister, because I don't know, you never know how long she'll be here. Not knowing that that day was the day that I would walk into my car seeing my daughter having a seizure, because one of my children asked for the keys to the car and she followed behind thinking we were leaving and closed the door on her and didn't know. So my daughter was actually dying from the heat of the car. And so for me to crank my car up and turn around, now I'm seeing my baby and I'm looking like, what? So that day is when my sister's keeper started, because that was the worst day of my life. She was my
How
heart.
Was she?
She was going to be turning two. She was actually my birthday gift. She was born August 2nd. I was born August 3rd. So my ex-husband's birthday was in June, like, I think June 8th, because she died June 9th, June 10th. So we went out and we celebrated the day before, and I never forget, I sat her on my bathroom counter. It was a double sink, and I was looking at her, and I was like, man, you're so pretty. She had some curly black jet hair, and she was just looking at me like, to go back at it now, like, she knew that was the last day that she was going to be there. Because I remember walking down that same, I'm sorry.
It's okay. Take it down.
I remember walking down the same hallway where she died. And that week, she started screaming. She just started yelling, holding me tight. And I'm like, what's wrong with you, Naya? What's wrong? And I started looking, because I can honestly say it's like she saw something that I could not see in my eyes. And when I go back at it, I believe that she saw the spirit of death, like it was just waiting there. And so to recap everything that took place, and to know that you have to find your child and then try to, you know, I walked into the shower to try to cool her down. And at that particular time, she turned purple. And I'm looking down at my baby like, I know logically from what they taught us in school, if she's purple, she's not breathing. So I'm trying to do CPR, and the more I'm trying
to do CPR. Was someone calling the ambulance at the time?
At that time, my ex-husband, I'm yelling, I'm like, you know, this is Naya. And he's looking like, what's going on? Everything happened so fast. And so all I knew is it was hot. I see all this sweat. All she had was a pamper. I'm in the shower, cooling her down. I look down, I'm like, Jesus, I'm calling on Jesus. I'm calling on Jesus. And I go to do CPR. Nothing's going on. And I hear this noise like, and the smell coming out of her. And I'm like, okay, this is not working. I know I'm doing this right. Mm-hmm. So by that time, my next door neighbor runs in and he's like, hey, is everything okay? I was like, he was like, the ambulance is there. So I run out. And so the ambulance taking all their little sweet time. And I know in my head, my baby is not breathing. The longer she's not breathing and she's purple, she's going to be brain dead. Mm-hmm. So they open up, you know, the ambulance, the doors. And so I'm like, here, this is my child. And so the man looking like, whoa, he thinking I'm handing him a doll baby. I'm like, no, this is my baby. Mm-hmm. So he like, oh, so all of a sudden they close it, the doors. And so therefore, they're now trying to bring her back.
They're trying to resuscitate her at that time. Okay.
So I'm sitting there and all I can do is call on Jesus at that point. So I'm like, Jesus, I know you can do this. And I'm like, Jesus, I'm crying out to him. I don't think I called on Jesus like that any day in my life. Mm-hmm. So then they opened the door. They're like, okay, we got a pulse. You know, everything is okay. My heart was not relieved. The worst thing that I thought that I was walking into was going to a hospital. You know, probably she'd be in intensive care, right. But then she was going to recover. She's all right. Because they were like, she's okay. Mm-hmm. The minute that I saw them start roping off with yellow tape around my car,
you know,
my mind was like, no, that meant death. I was like, please don't tell me my child is dead. Mm-hmm. So they was like, no, this is a crime scene investigation. We have to do this way. But I'm like, okay, but I want to go be with my child. I want to go see about it. You know, she by herself. Let me go run in the house, get her some clothes so I can be with my baby. They wouldn't let me leave. They was like, no, the car can't go anywhere. I'm like, I don't have any family. I'm here. They were like, well, you better find somebody. So to be at a state in your life where you're searching for help and nobody's not willing enough to help you. Mm-hmm. This is another time in my life. I'm reaching out, crying out, mm-hmm. and they're investigating. So now I'm scared because, like, I'm like, I don't want to go to jail because I know people can go to jail for that stuff. Mm-hmm. And it was a simple day being a wife, being a mother, having a date to the point where now I find myself in a situation that's uncontrollable. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, okay, God, now what do I do now? So all I hear, the police can, oh, get the mother here, you know. So finally, one of the police officers, he was willing to drive me to the hospital. And in Port St. Lucie, everything was far. Nothing was really around at that time. Mm-hmm. And so I finally get there. And on the way there, I'm like, please, sir, please don't take me to this hospital. My child is dead. Please, sir. He's like, well, I can't make any promises. Just keep your composure. He was so cold. And I got my baby doll, baby. I bought for her from the store the night before. And I'm like, you know what? I'm going to the hospital. But I'm like, sir, please, there's something wrong. Mm-hmm. Please don't take me because I don't have nobody. Get to the hospital. I sit down. I'm in a chair like this next to the stretcher. Next thing I know, they're like, I see them pumping her. Mm-hmm. And they're like, well.
Did they let you go in the room? You're in the room?
Okay. I was in the room.
Okay.
And next to the bed, and I see my baby stretched out on the bed. And I'm like, they're like, ma'am, we tried for 30 minutes, but, you know, she's gone. And I'm looking like, she's gone. And then I see my baby eyes, they folded back. That's when it's like, it hit like, boom. Mm-hmm. And I'm in the chair like, it's like my heart was snatched away from me at that very moment till I couldn't even breathe. And I'm like, no. Out of all my children, she was like the closest to me. Where I went, she wanted to go. Mm-hmm. So I had to get on the phone from that point, call my ex-husband. He's screaming over the phone. Now, my kids who actually went to the car that day, mm-hmm. I could understand their feeling because now they love their sister. Now, mm-hmm. oh, my God, we did something wrong. My sister's dead because they trying to figure out which one of you guys closed the door on her. Yeah. It was just a lot. I called my mom. My mom fainted over the phone. Mm-hmm. So now I'm going through shock. I'm having bowel movements where I couldn't even hold my bowel. I'm telling the nurse, I'm so sorry. In the bathroom because it just all hit me. Mm-hmm. But at that time, I'm not going to lie. I loved God, but I hated him at that point because I said, I know you hurt me when I was calling on you. I done seen you my whole life. I seen people be set free, delivered. I seen people come off of drugs. Mm-hmm. But at the time when I needed you the most, mm-hmm. you wouldn't even come bring That's my daughter a hurt back.
Feeling, huh?
It was the worst feeling. So at that point, I think I was atheist, but I really was.
For how long?
For a good hour, because I was on that ground. They had to really give me a shot because I was out of it. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking, they was like, do you want to hold your baby? I was like, no, let me go get my husband. I'm going to come back. You know, just hold her. Let me go back home, bring my husband back, and then I can hold her. Mm-hmm. So not knowing that they was going to take her away immediately, and I guess, you know, do the autopsy. And so I never even really tried, got a chance to even hold her or anything. Mm-hmm. So to endure all of that, it was very hard. And coming back on the road, I started having panic attacks and everything in the home. But on that road down, I saw a rainbow on this side of the highway and a rainbow on the other side. And it was as when I was coming back to Miami, like the hands of God began to hold my heart. That's the only thing that stopped me from hurting. And it was like somebody was just stabbing me in my heart with knives. Mm-hmm. And it was a process. It didn't go, the pain didn't go away overnight. Okay. But the pain went away with Jesus. I will say that. Mm-hmm. Once I came back, you know, my family support at that time, DCF, of course, monitored for a year, you know, but I found myself being in the church. They prayed with me. You know, I was crying all the time. Mm-hmm. But the more I started drawing myself to Jesus, the more he started healing me. Mm-hmm. The more I kept doing stuff. And I guess that's why I do so much now, because I could never stop.
Right.
So my sister's keeper came out of her death. The more I kept going before God, the more I kept, you know, searching after him, the more I was like, I know that this is here, but God, you're comforting me.
Mm-hmm.
And from that point, that's where it kept my sister's keeper going.
So my sister keeper, is that just for parents who go through the death of their child? What are the different parts of it? That's, I know
my
that's not the
keeper
only thing.
It's really
that you
a
do.
Ministry to keep, for women to keep each other.
Okay.
And it came out of a ministry, a church that I was really attending, because ministry has always been in me. Mm-hmm. As far as community. I'm a firm believer. If you're going to do something and you say something, then you need to do it. Mm-hmm. Don't just tell me scriptures. I've always been considered like a rebel. You can preach scriptures all day in and out. I'm tired of hearing scriptures. And
put
the
some
world,
action about
the world now, mm-hmm. when I was out there hurting, when I was homeless 4 years ago. I didn't know in the church, to the point where you can give me a scripture, but what am I going to do it when I'm going through that process? Okay, if I done paid my tithes, done paid my 10%, and I'm seeing it pressed down, shake. You telling me press down, shake it together, run it over with your men, come and bring it into my bosom. But I look at my refrigerator and I still see it empty.
That's right.
What do I do at that point? Because I know I have the faith. I know I trust God. Mm-hmm. And I know. You talking about going, you got to go through this process. It's not your season. But then when it's my season, when I keep going through all this brokenness, then that's when God say people need some type of organization, because the pastors get tired of counseling. They don't got time for you. Mm-hmm. Because we have so many roots and so much going on, they so focused on our character, but you don't know why I'm the way that I am.
It's deeper than what they see.
Did anybody take out the time to really find out the road that has gotten me here? No, because they're so focused on the offering, and they're so focused on, you know, me, the way that I learn, I'm a visual learner. So I may take a little bit longer to get what you're saying. Mm-hmm. A little 30-minute sermon not going to do good for me. You know, that's even when I go home, because my mind is constantly racing on the things of the past, I can't even really get the word in like I really should. So, because they'll be like, oh, that's when you need to make your own study time with the Lord, honey.
Yeah.
So God dealt with me. People don't have enough time because people don't really care.
They don't.
They don't care.
It's just a ritual. Mm-hmm. Church, you go to church, you get out, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
You go to Bible study, you go back to church again on Sunday. They're not trying. They need to reach the basic needs of the people. Because it's a lot of people that's coming into the churches that's hurting, that's broken. And it's not because they're not doing things because they want to do it. It's something that's rooted deep down.
And they need deliverance.
From their childhood.
Deliverance.
A lot of them is from the childhood. We have a lot of people that's out there on drugs that are doing, you know, all kind of things. All kind of things. But why?
Sweet.
They don't even know. A lot of pastors out there pastoring, and they're not even called. A lot of them, it's a business.
Once upon a time, on August 2nd, 2005, Rudy and Sharina Joseph shared the greatest joy that anyone could receive on this earth, a gift of a beautiful princess. They named her Shania Latrice Joseph. Her hair was as black as ebony, and her skin as soft as snow. It was no mystery that they called her Snow White. Everyone was so excited to welcome her into the palace.
We've been waiting.
Her big sister, Princess Cheyenne, and big brothers, Prince Javon and Prince Tyrese, all rejoiced as they received the newest addition to their royal family. Princess Shania touched the lives of so many people. The sparkle in her eyes brought joy to everyone in the land. They knew that there was something very special about Princess Shania. She wasn't just any princess. Her light shines so bright that you can see it far beyond her own palace. Princess Shania showered her mommy and daddy with so much love, giving far more hugs and kisses than normal. As she turned around and screamed, "Hi!" to her grandmother for the first and last time. She returned to her palace to spend more precious moments with her loving family. One morning, the princess sat in her magical carriage and went on a wonderful adventure. As she made her way through an enchanted forest, she grew tired and fell asleep. Gentle kiss upon her cheek and woke up to find a host of angels
so pretty, Mama.
Singing and dancing, all welcoming her. As she entered the gates of heaven, Princess Shania had never seen a kingdom so beautiful, but that was nothing compared to the beauty of King Jesus. As he stood over her and kissed her soft cheek, to her surprise, Princess Shania grew beautiful angel wings. So she spread them and floated into his arms. Amazed by his beauty,
hello, Shania.
She wished everyone from her royal family could be there to see King Jesus too. He picked her up and held her close to his heart. She loved it when mommy and daddy would hold and kiss her, but it was nothing like this. Never had she been so happy in fact, she never wanted to leave. Everyone in the land was so sad to see Princess Shania go, but the seed of her love she planted helped everyone to grow. Princess Shania lived happily ever after in the majestic kingdom with King Jesus, waiting patiently until the day she would see her love once again. So rest on, sleeping beauty. Close your pretty little eyes. Your job here on earth is done. But your spirit will live on in our lives.
Possess a gift or two. One of them is this. They have the power to make a wish come true.
Starlight,
wish I may, I wish I might. Have the wish I wish tonight. We'll make a wish and do as dreamers do.
You folks don't believe that about a wish coming true, do you? Well, I didn't either. Of course, I'm just a cricket, but let me tell you what made me change my mind. You see, the most fantastic, magical things can happen, and it all starts with a wish.
Are born, they possess a gift or two. One of them is this: they have the power to make a wish come true.
Starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight. I wish I may, I wish I might. Have the wish I wish tonight. We'll make a wish and do as dreamers.
Folks don't believe that about a wish coming true, do you? Well, I didn't either. Of course, I'm just a cricket, but let me tell you what made me change my mind. You see, the most fantastic, magical things can happen, and it all starts with a wish.